Hello everyone, hope you all are doing well. So we'll begin the third part of our series of lecture on radiographic techniques, safety and protection. And today we'll be discussing the few other parts such as image characteristics, projection, the other specialized intraoral radiography techniques that we use in our dental clinics, and also some common faults that occur in intraoral radiology. So to start off with, so far what we have covered, just to reiterate, radiographic films used in intraoral radiology, film holders, latent image, techniques for taking IOPA, that is the paralleling and bisecting angle techniques, and processing of radiographs. With processing of last time, we just got an overview as to how the processing is done. So again, to just summate regarding processing of radiographs, we all know film processing can be done either manual or automatic. Automatic, you have a machine for it in which you feed the radiographic film on one end of the machine, and it does the processing for you, and finally developed, and in some cases of automatic processor, even dried and given to you on the other end. So this is automatic processor. So what happens in manual processing? So there are two methods for manual processing: time and temperature method and visual method. Now in mind, there are three major steps, or let us say four major steps involved in film processing, which is immersing the film in developer, then water, then fixer, then washing it thoroughly on running water, and drying it off with a proper drying equipment. So these steps are common for both the method, both the types of processing, that is, be it visual method or be it time temperature control method. The steps involved in the film processing are the same. The pattern and the order is the same. You take the film packet, you put it inside the chamber, or you go inside a dark room, you open the packet, remove the film, put it in developer, then water, then consecutively to fixer, then wash it in running water and dry it off. So this format is the same, but how we approach this format is going to be different in time, temperature and visual method. So the one of the most commonest method, which is very prevalently followed, is the visual method, because it does not need any conditions, or it does not need any different kind, any specialized or any particular set timing condition or anything like that. Visual method, the name is derived from the fact that every part, that is every section or every step along the way, we are going to visualize and we are going to do the processing. So once you remove the film from the packet, then you're going to immerse it in the developer, and while you keep immersing, and keep dipping it into developer, taking it out, at the same time you're going to visualize the radiograph, so to see whether the image is getting formed on it. And when you see that the desirable image is achieved on the IOPA after developing, that is after you visualize the image, then you transfer it to water, nicely rinse it, so it will remove any excessive developer sticking to the surface, then put it in the fixer. So in fixer, again you keep fixing until you get, until the image clears and you get a perfectly perfect IOPA with a good contrast. And once it's fixed, then take it out, then rinse it with water and dry it off. So every step along the way you are going to visualize and do. This is visual method. So you will understand the benefit that you get with visual method when we talk about time and temperature method. So time and temperature method, there is no need to visualize anything, because as we all know, the developer and fixer, one is acidic, one is acidic in nature, and they have to be maintained in a certain temperature if you want to maintain the acidity and acidic nature of these solutions. And also the atmospheric, the temperature, that is the temperature within the dark room, and the concentration of the solution. So developer and fixer, they are usually supplied in two forms. One is they are either supplied in powder form or they are supplied in concentrated liquid form. So what we have to do is we have to proportionate it. Usually it is indicated by the manufacturer. Whichever company is manufacturing these developer and fixer, they give you the composition as to how much of water you should add and dilute how much. Or powder means how many grams of powder to be added in how many liters of water. So this will be given by the manufacturer themselves. So the concentration that has been indicated has to be stringently followed. So when you follow all this, what happens is that you will get an you will do something called as a test radiograph at the beginning of the day. So what you will be doing is you will be doing a a test radiograph, not against a patient but against an object, just to see the contrast. So then you will put it inside the solution and you will calculate the time. So let us say, for example, it is 10 seconds in developer it takes to form an image. You note down the time, 10 seconds, and then water, and then water, how much time you have to rinse it in water properly. In the next this thing, that will be another 10 seconds, then fixer. So this timing I'm telling you tentatively, but it will be decided by the test radiograph. Then after that, every consecutive radiograph that you are going to take for a patient, all you need to do is, you don't need to visualize, you just put it inside the solution and you count the time. 10 seconds, next water, 10 seconds, then fixer, 10 seconds, and you rinse it nicely with water, you will have a a radiograph with a very good contrast. So here you don't need to visualize. So the idea is that the resultant radiograph consecutively, whichever you're taking, the processing will be uniform. That is, you will get a quality image of the same kind. Only difference or only problem, disadvantage with the time and temperature method is the following the ability to maintain the temperature with for the for the solution, for the dark room, and also the concentration of the solution. Because as you process over a certain number of radiograph, the potential of the solution loses its potential a little bit. So that has to be replenished. So it makes it a little it's too technical. It is a little difficult for a technician to keep up to all this too. But this is a very preferred method when you are going to do it, especially when one person is going to handle, let us say, a few hundred radiograph IOPAs in a day is going to process. Then this is the most preferred, because we do not have to visualize. There are hospitals and clinics and institutions where they process, they have a larger holders, and where they process at least 10 to 15 IOPAs in the same, in one shot. When you do something like that, this time and temperature method becomes very useful, because you can't visualize and you cannot individually do it for separate radiographs. So uniformly you can develop all 15 radiographs if you follow time temperature control method. But if you are just going to do an individual radiograph, the preferred choice of method would be a visual method. And this visual method, you can visualize every step along the way. So a desirable contrast, a desirable quality of the image over the IOPA can be achieved. So these are the two most popular methods that are being used for developing. And in our institution, we generally use visual method, because most of the time we are going to be developing only one radiograph at a time. So it makes it makes sense when we use visual method for this. So these are the two methods. So to just to submit, the steps for film processing is developing, putting the film in the developer, then water, then fixer, rinsing it and drying it. It's common for both these steps are common for both visual and time temperature method. So the only difference comes here we have a controlled time and temperature, and controlled time in which you are going to about which you are going to immerse the film into the solutions, whereas in visual method you are going to visualize this every step along the way. So these are the two steps of processing an intraoral periapical film. Okay, So moving on to bitwing radiograph. So far what we have seen is an intraoral periapical radiograph. Apart from this, we also have something called as a bitwing radiograph. We would have been given a general introduction on it on your first lecture. So to start off with bitwing radiograph, the name is derived from the fact that we use a tab or a folder which is called the wing, on which the patient bites for us to achieve this radiograph. And this radiograph is predominantly used for detection of interproximal caries and to see the height of the alveolar bone. Okay, so the major difference here, why we do not do intraoral periapical radiograph and why we prefer bitwing radiograph, is that in intraoral periapical radiograph you see the tooth on the hole, that is from the tip of the crown to the tip of the root and the surrounding structures of the root. Not just the root, you also see to certain extent the surrounding structures, that is the alveolar bone and all the structures related to the root you see in the intraoral periapical radiograph. Whereas the bitwing radiograph is majorly concentrated on the crowns and the superior part of the tooth, rather than that the apical region. So the apical region is generally not visualized in the bitwing radiograph. Only the crowns are visualized. The ability to distinctively see, as you can see in the image, distinctively see each teeth without any overlap or without any artifact, gives us a very good edge in terms of visualizing proximal lesions related to the tooth and the height of the alveolar crest, which is very important for periodontal diseases. So for this, the patient's head is normally positioned same as the IOPA, the occlusal plane, whereas in this case the patient will be biting, the occlusal plane will be maintained parallel to the parallel to the floor. And in case you are going to use a tab, which is like a small this thing which we the picture we showed in our last last presentation. So this is a very traditional method. Using a tab is a very traditional method. So what they generally do is, it is the film is run through a sleeve, and the sleeve will have an extension, and the patient is asked to bite over the extension. And the film position should be noted. Make sure that the exposure side is facing towards the tube, and the patient bites, and you have to ensure that the film is covering the crowns of the upper and lower tooth. So this is using a tab, or you can also use a ring device, which we do, which is shown here in the slide on the right hand top corner, the ring device. And positioning the ring device is shown in the image below. So here the ring bitwing instrument is used instead of a tab, and the instrument facilitates the placement of the ring ensures correct alignment to the position indicating device of the X-ray machine. So all you have to do is make the patient bite and align the PID with the ring of this device, and you get a bitwing radiograph. So this is the bitwing radiograph, and we, like I told you, remember this is used mostly predominantly for detection of proximal caries. Moving on, okay, we have the maxillary occlusal view. Okay, the maxillary and mandible occlusal view gives us the image of the complete dental arch, related either if it is maxillary occlusal view, the maxilla, if it is mandibular occlusal view, then we use it along the mandible. Here it is shown how the positioning, so the film itself is larger in size, so that it can be inserted as a disc, like a disc between, and it can be positioned, and it is positioned between the maxillary and mandibular arch, and the patient is asked to bite. In most of the cases, the film is rectangular in shape, and it is positioned horizontally, not vertically, not the broader side is inserted into the patient's mouth. And in terms of younger adults who have a, you know, much smaller arch, you can even place it vertically. So it is positioned and patient is asked to mildly bite on the film, and after that the position indicating device of the x-ray tube is projected, and this projection the central ray should pass through your upper part of the nasal apparatus through the orbit to the maxillary area. So approximately the angulation will be somewhere between 40 to 50 degree positive angulation. This is for the maxillary radiograph, maxillary occlusal radiograph, and the image is as descriptive as it can be. And how to read this maxillary radiographs, we'll discuss that when we talk about radiographic interpretations. The idea of getting a maxillary radiograph is that you are able to, along with the tooth, you will not be able to visualize each and every tooth individually, but a general overview of the tooth, and apart from that you will also be able to clearly visualize the palate. So any palatal lesions or any lesions associated from the with the tooth that extends to the palate, and also you want to locate the lesion. So to start off with this particular this particular IOPA or bite wing, it only gives you a two-dimensional perspective. That is, you can only see where the lesion is present in one dimension. But if you want an idea in another dimension, so instead of an a mesial distal dimension, you want it from anteroposterior dimension or buccopalatal dimension, it's a go-to method for doing a maxillary occlusal view. Similarly, it goes for mandibular occlusal view. And here again, it is the same way, only the film is inverted and the exposure side is facing the mandible now, and patient is asked to bite. Patient is asked to tilt the head a little behind, and you are going to project, and you are going to ensure that the central ray of the X-ray is perpendicular to the X-ray tube, and you get what is called a true occlusal. Here you are able to visualize the, along with the tooth, the cortical plates of the mandible, that is the borders of the mandible. So any expansile lesion involving the mandible can be visualized, that is the body of the mandible can be visualized with the occlusal radiograph. Again, then it has its limitations. You can push the film only as far as the patient can take it, or let us say until the dental arch, extent of the dental arch, and you cannot push the film beyond that. Beyond that, the patient is going to have gag reflex and is not going to be cooperative. So it has its own limitations, both maxillary and mandibular occlusal view. You get a very, a concise area of the palate, maxilla, and here in terms of mandible, the body of the mandible, the anterior part of the body of the mandible. Anything further, it is better to opt for an higher end of imaging, such as an OPG or CBCT, not stick to occlusal view. An occlusal view is still a very commonly practiced radiographic projection in terms of intraoral radiology. Advantages: it does not need any specialized instrument or any device for making this radiograph. Only thing is the radiograph for occlusal has to be procured separately. Then there is this concept called full mouth radiograph. Okay, this is a concept that is slowly lost its its importance, or it's lost its its position in the in our field of dental radiology. But even before OPG, the orthopantomograph, or any higher end of imaging was not still very much accessible to common dental practitioners. And in certain cases of specialty treatments, especially in periodontics and orthodontics, in some cases they follow a concept called a full mouth radiograph. Instead of taking an OPG or anything where the entire thing can be visualized, they use a set of 10 radiographs to completely visualize all the dental tooth. So upper 5, lower 5. So the central incisors will be covered with central and lateral incisors will be covered with one IOPA, and then you will have your canine and premolar in one IOPA and molars in another IOPA. So five including both sides, so it will be five in the upper and five in the lower. The idea is, in some cases where you are doing a complete mouth, full mouth rehabilitation, periodontal rehabilitation, where you are going to do, let us say for example, a root planing or a flap surgery, to increase the accuracy of imaging and to get a, you know, good, better perspective of the bone level as compared to, because previously in earlier generations of orthopantomograph, we had this problem of magnification error. So the preferred choice of studying bone level or the bone height in a patient was taking an IOPA, which is considered to be much more accurate than that of OPG. So they used to take a full mouth radiographs, 10 consecutive radiographs, IOPAs. But today this has lost its importance, because one is the accuracy of the orthopantomograph has significantly increased. We have very well advanced into field of orthopantomograph. The magnification error has been brought down to its minimum. So whatever detail you're expecting to derive from a full mouth radiograph can be derived from an OPG. And also the advent of digital radiography helps us to deliver literally, in half a dose of all the 10 IOPAs, you will still be able to achieve an OPG because of the advent of digital radiography. So that becomes a preferred choice today. But nonetheless, even today, there are a few conventional, practices which still uses full mouth radiography in their practice. So this is just for your information. I don't think we'll be ever using full mouth radiography as far as we go, but but under rare circumstances, when we are going to go through a specialized technique or specialized procedure, when it is required, it is something that is still being followed. Okay, that brings us next to something called as object localization. Here, object localization is a concept. It is not a modality like IOPA or occlusal or bite wing. It is a concept, object localization. Like I told you, the IOPA, the occlusal, or all of these images are all like bite wing, are all two-dimensional images. So when you are trying to position something, or when you are trying to locate something, let us say for example a foreign object inside the patient's mouth, you are going to get the perspective only in one dimension. That is, you will know whether it is mesial to the structure or distal to the structure when you see the IOPA, but it will not give you a very good idea whether it is located palatally or lingually. Palatally or buccally, or lingually or buccally. In upper it is palatal and buccal, in lower it is lingual and buccal. So this information is not acquired by a plain IOPA or bite wing or occlusal. So under these conditions, we follow a principle or a methodology called object localization. Here you have two techniques to locate an object or localize an object using intraoral radiographic films. The easiest way today will be is to take a CBCT and do it, but again, everywhere it is not an accessible, and CBCT can be pretty expensive also. And if you know where this object is located tentatively by doing a clinical examination and primary radiograph, and the object size is very small, then you can follow these principles to locate that object and take further action. So for this we have two techniques. One is the cross-sectional or right angle technique, and then you have the tube shift technique, or it is otherwise called the bucket object rule, or it is sometimes called the Richard's rule or Clark's rule. So first we'll use the what are its uses? Its uses are localization techniques for pathosis, supernumerary teeth, fractures and foreign bodies. So first we'll start with right angle technique. So right angle technique is a combination of two different types of radiography. So for example, if you want to locate the position of an impacted canine, once you can see in the image below, first you have taken a radiograph IOPA. You can see very well that the canine is impacted beneath the existing teeth in the arch. But only thing is, you can see that it is inferior to the lateral incisor. But only thing, the thing is that we do not know whether it is positioned buccal or palatal. So knowing whether it is positioned buccal or palatal gives the maxillofacial surgeon or the orthodontist, you know, to know the exact location and to, you know, get access to the tooth to either orthodontically bring it back to position or for a surgical removal. So the position or placement of incisions and, you know, the placement of devices within the patient's you know, arch, dental arch, can be decided using this technique. Here in this technique we use two modalities, two different modalities. One is the IOPA, which you see in the lower, the first. The second one, to position the buccal or palatal situation, we take an occlusal radiograph. Now in the first radiograph, like I told you can see whether it is, where it is exactly positioned, superior or inferior, or it is either mesial or distal. Now we know it is inferior, or it is you know, close to the maxillary lateral incisor, at almost at its root apex, and inferior to the canine, and it is positioned distal to the crown of the impacted tooth is positioned distal to the central incisor. But we do not know whether it is buccal or palatal. But when you look at the second image, you can see it is positioned palatally. So you use a combination of two different images to get the information, complete information, that is, locate the object exactly. Now when we collectively look at this information, now we know that this impacted canine tooth is positioned palatally, okay, is positioned palatally distal to the central incisor and at the apex of the you know, at the almost at the apex of the lateral incisor. So like this you position, and now it enables, and it is positioned like let us say 2 millimeter or 3 millimeter from the crest of the alveolar, from the alveolar crest of the lateral incisor. So this gives a very good idea to the surgeon or orthodontist to go about and do the treatment required. So this is a right angle technique where we use two different modalities, method that we use or principle that we use. So this is the same thing. The next that we use is called a SLOB, that is same lingual opposite side buccal technique. Okay, here we don't use two different types of radiographs. Here we use the same type of radiograph, that is an IOPA, but the information is derived not by changing the IOPA, but by changing the position of the tube. Okay, so what we do is we take a normal SCOUT radiograph. So we are going to take two consecutive radiographs using this. In this technique, we are going to take two consecutive IOPAs. So we'll take a normal regular IOPA, which in this technique we will call a SCOUT image. We'll take a normal regular IOPA. Then what we will do is we will shift the tube. Remember, in projection geometry, we align the central ray in a certain way for to achieve the IOPA. But here in this technique, we break that rule and we move apart and we do either a distal shift or a mesial shift, or that is, we either move the cone mesially, that is forward or behind, and we project towards that radiograph and we take another X-ray. So we'll see that little bit in detail. So this is called an horizontal shift. As you can see in the image, the pink color represents our normal IOPA, which we take. As you all know, the central ray is aimed and it goes interdental, and it goes and it's perpendicular to the film or the receptor. Whereas the red color is the tube shift, where you have shifted the tube horizontally, you have shifted the tube, and you are going to take another unconventional IOPA, which is going to give us the position. Here you can see in film A, the position of the object, which is here indicated in terms of the yellow and red dot, is at the apex of the mesiobuccal root. But in film B, it is at the distal, it is almost moved distal to the mesial root. It is here exactly on the mesial root, mesiobuccal root. Here it has moved from mesiobuccal root towards the between the mesiobuccal root and the palatal root. You can see that the dot has moved from the from IO in as a result of IOPA1 and IOPA2. This movement of the object is what is going to help us detect exactly where this object is located, whether it is buccal or palatal. This is where we are going to use the slob rule, which we saw before, which translates to slob means same side lingual opposite buccal. So if the object moves along the same direction as your tube shift, so you're moving the you're shifting the tube distally, and the object also moves distally in the second radiograph, then it is on the same side, which means it is positioned lingually or palatally. But you position or you move it distally, and the object's object shifts mesially, that is the opposite side, then it is positioned buccally. Okay, let's see it with some examples so that we understand it pretty clearly. So you can see here in the diagram at the left, the buccal and the lingual objects of interest are superimposed and on each other, because the beam is directed perpendicular to both of them. Now they are both in same relative position, mesio distally and vertically. Both images are located above the second molar. You can see this. This is the reference image or the scout image. When you take a scout image, you can see that both the triangle and the circle are superimposed over each other. This is your normal image. And when you do an horizontal movement, what happens is that because of the alignment of the central ray, what happens is that the tube head is moved distally and the beam is directed mesially, and the buccal object of interest, that is the yellow circle, moves mesially opposite to the tube head of the movement in relation to the second molar, and the lingual object of interest, which is the red, which moves distally the same direction of the tube head in relation to the second molar. Similarly, there is also something called as vertical movement. Here now we do not commonly use a vertical tube shift. It is not a very common choice of tube shift, but in certain cases when you want to locate the object, again we use a vertical movement also. Again, a similar kind of a scout image, where you take a normal IOPA, you can see both the circle and the triangle are superimposed, and on a vertical movement you can see those that the a position of the circle and the triangle are replaced by the triangle going superior and the the circle being positioned inferior, as in contrast to the normal radiograph that we take. So we are going to use this principle here to locate the the object of interest. So again, for an example, another common example that we use, which will commonly come across, is that you can see that the first premolar is root canal treated. As we all know, the first premolar, it has you will have two canals. You have to obturate two canals, and when you take a normal radiograph, you can see only one canal is obturated. But when you do a tube shift, that is when you shift distally or mesially and you take a radiograph, you are able to visualize both these root canals which have been obturated. So this is one such example. So for example, if an object is located and first you take a normal scout radiograph, then you do a distal shift, that is you move the tube head distally and project and take an IOPA. Now in that image, from the original position, if the object has moved the same direction as your tube, that is you have done a distal shift and the object has also moved distal, then it is considered same side. So if it is same side, it is considered to be positioned lingually or palatally. But let us say you have done a distal shift, but the object resultant image, the object has come mesial to the original image compared to that of original image, then it is considered opposite side. If it has moved opposite side, it is considered to be positioned buccally. So what we will do is, when you all come back, we'll have a demonstration on this. So when you actually do it, when you actually practice it, it becomes much more easier in understanding. This is another image as an explanation of what I have already given to you previously. or today for positioning an object, depending on the size of the object, or and depending on the availability, you can go for an higher modality such as the CBCT, which will accurately tell you the exact position location in multiple dimensions. It can tell to you in multiple dimensions where these tooth are located. Okay, so just to sum it again, what we have seen so far is the bitwig radiograph, the occlusal radiograph, and we have also seen the principles of object localization or the methods of object localization. And now we move on, we'll briefly see the image characteristics of an X-ray film. Now, the image characteristics of an X-ray film is not predominantly a part of the, you know, our lecture, but let's just get an idea as to, like, because we talk about processing, we talk about a good quality of radiograph, we talk about we are getting a good image. So what is this image that we are talking about, and how do we know that it is a very good radiograph? For this we need to understand what is a characteristic of a good image. So under characteristics of an X-ray or an X-ray film, we have these we have these titles, that is the radiographic density, the radiographic contrast, the radiographic speed, the film latitude, radiographic noise, radiographic sharpness and resolution. See, the overall image quality is a combination of all these features. You need to have all these features for you to get a good quality of a radiograph. So we'll see a little bit or briefly about what are all these characteristics. To start off with image density, the overall degree of darkening of the exposed film is referred to as radiographic density. So when we tend to overdevelop, overprocess, or tend to overexpose. So in our previous presentation, I showed you there is a control panel where we choose which tooth we are going to expose and how much time we are going to expose film to for that particular tooth. So under that condition, sometimes when we tend to overexpose, that is, we are going to increase the time of exposure, or we are going to overdevelop, that increases the overall density of the radiograph. That is, it becomes more overall degree of darkening, not specific, but overall degree of darkening increases. This is referred to as density of radiograph, which is one of the primary characteristic of an ideal radiograph. You need to have a very good or a proper density of radiograph. So is density a bad thing? No, not necessary, not entirely. You need to have the exact amount of density if you want the image to have a perfect, kind of darkening and lightening, the variation. When it becomes overburn or when it becomes too much, then there is, increased radiographic density, and when it becomes lesser, there is decreased radiographic density. So a radiographic density is influenced by exposure, that is increased MA or KVP, or the exposure time, which relates to increased density, or the thickness of the subject. That is, let us say if you see the control panel image that we have shown before, you can see that there are variations, that either it's a heavily built person, or a moderately built person, or a very thin child, or a thin person. Or in some cases, it will be referred to us in terms of arch, very thick arch, or a very a normal arch, or a very thin or a small arch. So based on that, the thickness of the subject and also the subject density, based on this, the more dense the object is, it is better absorbed, and the more radio opaque it becomes. And lower the density of the object is, the weaker the absorption will be, and all the photons pass through, hence creating a radiolucent, that is a black pattern on the resultant X-ray film. So these are the factors influencing radiographic density. Like I told you before, the amount of exposure, and one thing that has not been added is overdeveloping, but darkening of an image can also be contributed to overdeveloping. But here, since we are focusing on acquiring an image, we are focusing more on the exposure part and also the thickness of the person. Moving on to radiographic contrast. Okay, this contrast is something I would like to, if you want to relate it to something, if you want to compare and relate it to something, You can relate it to the images that we take in our mobile phones these days. You take an image in our mobile phones, then you go into settings, you can adjust something called as the contrast. And this radiographic contrast is the range of density of the radiograph. So if when you adjust the contrast, you can see that the image becomes more vibrant, or it becomes less vibrant. This variation in density is brought about by the contrast, and the higher the contrast, images show the both light and dark areas, but the gray areas are short. But in low contrast, the images show only gray but dark areas, but it does not show the white areas that clearly. So it is important that we have contrast. Now, talking about gray, okay, this is something I almost tell all of my students throughout the years. I told all of my students, one of my most favorite terminology when it comes to radiography is shades of gray. We have some, we have some hundreds of shades of gray in radiography. Unfortunately, because of a movie, it is not something, the terminology which we cannot very commonly use along. But if you take the contrast, because radiography is black, white and gray, so if you take, there are various shades of black and there are various shades of, there is no various shades in white, but the transition from the black to white, there is something called as gray. And these, these various shades, these 250 odd shades of gray that we have, is what is going to help us differentiate between the various anatomic structures that are shown in the radiograph. This is an image that shows a grayscale. Now, this doesn't cover everything, but this is the grayscale that is used in a conventional radiograph, whereas your digital radiograph can pick up hundreds of various shades of gray. Conventional radiograph, this is the common grayscale that we kind of refer to. So we have proper black, we have a proper gray, and we have a proper white, and between this somewhere we have various levels of shades or various shades of gray, which varies. If you translate it in terms of IOPA, it varies from the one anatomic structure to another anatomic structure. For example, your soft tissues in your X-rays will give you a certain amount of gray. Your enamel will be totally translucent, that is white, whereas your pulp will be totally radiolucent, your enamel will be totally radio opaque, which is white, and your pulp will be totally radiolucent, which will be completely dark. So this variation about it is brought about by the image contrast. So the radiographic contrast is influenced by the subject contrast, depends on the subject thickness, density and atomic number. As the KVP of the X-ray beam increases, subject contrast decreases. And another concept is film fog, which is increased density of the film due to improper safe light storage and high temperature and developing under high temperature. We'll see about film fog as we go further. And then scattered radiation, it can be due to low KVP, collimation and grits. So this is just an example, a photographic example to show you the contrast. We can see that image 1, which is of a low contrast, and image 2, which is of a good contrast image. You are able to differentiate everything much clearly in the image, second image. So this is an image to just tell us about contrast, and similarly here, the first image has a much better contrast in comparison to the second image, where you can see the proximal caries of the bitwig here shown here in the first image much more clearly than that of the the one which has a low contrast in the shown in the second image. Then there is a concept called as film fogging. So it's just a reference, picture to show, like it's just like how you are not able to clearly visualize something when you go into a highly fogged area. Something similar to that, such kind of blurring of the image can happen to a film if under certain conditions, when there is very low KVP, when there is when there is contamination of the solution, that is when accidentally there is mixture of fixer into developer, developer into fixer, these kind of, and also when a film is compromised, that is, it is not stored in optimal condition, there is moisture collected within the film packet, or the film packet is almost towards expired or almost towards expiry, sometimes you get this film fog. So the clarity of the image is gone away. And then we have speed. We have already discussed speed of the film previously, the amount of radiation required to produce an image of standard density, and a fast film requires lower exposure to produce a density of 1. Slower film requires longer exposure. So the fastest being speed F, which is faster than speed E, and which is faster than speed D. We don't use ABC anymore. And the insight is required, that is, speed F requires, F speed film requires only half the exposure time and half the radiation dose of ultra speed film, that is E speed films. And the film speed depends on the size of the silver halide grains and the content of the silver. And in F speed films, the tubular crystals are present, and it is and has more silver components, thus making thus increasing the efficiency of the film. All this we have discussed before, first lecture. Then comes the film latitude. It is the measure and range of exposures that can be recorded as distinguishable densities on the film. So when a film with wide has a wide latitude, it can display a wide range of subject contrast, useful to see both of osseous structures and skull and soft tissue and facial region. Now keep this thing in mind. Your X-ray imaging is generally not a go-to, or is not an ideal way of imaging any soft tissue lesions. You will never get a very good soft tissue contrast using an X-ray imaging. For soft tissue, we generally prefer doing an MRI or an ultrasound. The preferred things to see via an X-ray is generally the heart tissue, that is the bones. So, but when you increase the scope, that is, you take all the components of the film and the X-ray machine that is given to you and use all the things to your advantage, you can increase the range of that film, that is widening the latitude, can display here in this lateral cephalogram that is shown in the image. You can see the outline. You will not be able to distinguish the soft tissue within very clearly, but you can see the outline of the soft tissue. You can see the outline of the person's face, and you can very clearly also see the bone. That is increasing a wide display, wide latitude. But if you restrict the latitude, if you narrow it down, you will only be able to see the bone of the person, that is the osseous structures, not the soft tissue. Then you have something called as radiographic noise. Now this concept is there in photography. People who are familiar with using not mobile cameras but DSLR cameras are familiar with image noise. There is something called as an image noise. It is the appearance of uneven density of an uniformly exposed radiographic film, and the main cause of noise is radiation mottle and radiation artifacts. So radiation mottle means it is uneven densities resulting from physical structure of the film, that is the grainness of the film, or when a high temperature is used, and defects caused by error by handling the film, that is such as fingerprints, bends, processing errors and stretch marks. Then moving on to radiographic sharpness and resolution. Again, these you can relate to them to your digital photographs that you take. When you open the settings of your in your gallery or your camera, you can see these things, the contrast and your sharpness, or and you can also adjust the resolution, where you go for either high resolution image or moderately resolution and low resolution image. So here the sharpness of the image is the ability to define the edge of a structure precisely. Example, the enamel dentin junction, that is your ability to differentiate without being uniform, your ability to differentiate between enamel and dentin, and the thin trabecular plate. And resolution is, or resolving power, is the ability of the radiograph to record separate structure that are close together, and how well the radiograph is able to relieve small objects that are close together. These are independent and determine the clarity of the image. So resolution generally refers to the clarity of the image, and sharpness is the is the ability to define an image, that is precisely, that is clearly. So it is measured is as the highest number of line pairs per millimeter that can be distinguished. That is how we kind of like determine the resolution. A panoramic film, that is an OPG film, can resolve 5 lines a pair in compared to that of IOP film, which has a better resolution, which can do up to 20 line per pairs in a millimeter. That is, within a millimeter of the film, you can distinguishly draw 20 lines, and you will be still able to see those 20 lines distinguishly in an IOP film, whereas only up to 5 lines can be seen in an OPG films, which goes to show that your IOP films has a superior resolution and sharpness in comparison to that of an OPG film. So this is one such example to show the resolution. If you take the overall image which is given in the right hand bottom corner, and if you want to if you want to define the resolution and sharpness, you can refer to the larger image, the outermost circle being of low resolution and low contrast, moving on to the second circle where you have a much better contrast and a much better resolution, and the final image within the smallest circle where you have the best of increased resolution and increased contrast. So the increased resolution also contributes to how much you can enlarge the image and how much more detailed you can visualize the image. Again, this is another example to show in terms of this is just a reference image as photography, like I told you. So a lot of similarity between photography here and radiography, and this is just an example to show how it works. So low contrast, high resolution; high contrast, low resolution; and when you have an high contrast, high resolution. So all of these are not a very ideal situation for you to acquire a very good image. So it has to have a balanced contrast and a balanced resolution. So methods of minimizing loss of image clarity. One is use as small as an effective focal spot as practical, and increasing the distance between the focal spot and the object by using long and open-ended cylinder, and minimize the distance between the object and the film. These are the methods to minimize the loss of image clarity. Then we have something called as a peripheral eggshell effect. Now this peripheral eggshell effect is something which you will be able to appreciate in terms of, there is something called as a laminar dura, which is a radiographic concept, and also the cortical plate or the bone, which is very well appreciated. Now, the best example to demonstrate this peripheral eggshell effect is using an egg, which is shown here in the image. We all know that the eggshell that covers the egg is of uniform thickness. It is not of varying thickness. It is of uniform thickness, and it encompasses the soft part or the component of an egg entirely, right? Uniformly, entirely and uniformly. But when you take an X-ray and see, that uniformity is not demonstrated here in the radiograph. You can see that the edge of the egg is highlighted, that is with a white line, and this is what we refer to as a peripheral eggshell effect. Even though the amount of the eggshell covering the egg is uniform, we only get on the in the two dimensional image we only get on the egg the periphery, that is the edge of the egg, we get the radio opaque line. This same principle, or whatever we talked about before, using and we demonstrated with an egg, is applied when it is applied directly to our human anatomy. The concept of laminar dura, the floor of the maxillary sinus, and the sclerotic margins you see along the cysts and other lesions are all a result of this peripheral eggshell effect. To reiterate, when we talked about SLOB, that is the buccal object rule method, and when we talk about peripheral eggshell effect, because there are certain concepts here which you are not still entirely introduced to. There are certain things that you are not still entirely introduced to. So you might not understand it right away, but eventually you will understand as we go on further and we discuss and we bring in more and more information, it will become much clearer to you. And another way of becoming clearer is when we give you a clinical demonstration, or when we discuss it in person with examples, when we with sample images and examples, we do it directly, and when it is shown in a person as to how it is done and how the result is interpreted, it will be much more clearer to you. So do not worry if it is a little confusing. Let me know if you are not very clear about it. We'll because until you come back to the campus to attend classes, what we can do is we can hold a discussion online for the topics that you are not very clear upon via lecture. Moving on to the common radiographic faults that we see in radiograph. So the faulty radiographs are referred to as poor quality radiographs that contribute to the loss of diagnostic information and loss of professional and patient type. So one of the common radiographic fault is what we see is image shape distortion. It is a result of unequal magnification of different parts of the same object. And this happens when not all the parts of the object are in the same focal spot to object distance and position of the film parallel to the long axis of the object and orient the central ray perpendicular to the object of the film. This can be a result of incorrect angulation, that is positioning of the tube, the projection geometry that we talk about. When we do an incorrect positioning of the tube, that may end up in resulting, that is foreshortening of the image. That is foreshortening of the image is because the image size will shrink. This image size shrink, it is caused by the projection of the central ray from an angle that is too great. When you increase the angulation, whether it is positive or negative angulation, let us say for example you are supposed to give 30 degree of angulation and you increase it and give 40-50 degree of angulation, then that results in foreshortening. And elongated image, that is elongation, that is it stretches out, the image stretches out, and this is caused due to when you put the angulation too small. That is when an ideal radiograph, let us say you have to give 30 degree of angulation but you give 20 or 10, it causes elongation. So this is caused, this image shape distortion is caused due to the incorrect vertical angulation of the position indicating device. The common problems in film exposure and development, the common complications that we come across are the processing, that is processing errors. Let us say for example light radiographs and dark radiographs. Light radiographs can be result of due to processing errors such as underdevelopment, depleted or diluted or contaminated developer, or excessive fixation, or in terms while taking radiograph, insufficient MAKBP or exposure time exposure, or film packet is reversed in the mouth, where you get a tire truck appearance, and the film source distance is too great. That is, you increase the distance between the X-ray tube head and the receptor. You might get a light radiograph, whereas dark radiographs are a resultant of processing errors such as overdevelopment, concentrated developer, inadequate time in fixer, improper safe lighting, or accidental exposure to light, or expired films. And overexposure can also be a reason when there is excessive MAKBP and time, and when you keep the film source distance too short, can result in darker radiographs. That is, the crest of the image is affected. Then there is film fog. The film fog, as we discussed before, occurs due to improper safe lighting, or when there is a light leak within the dark room or the chamber where you are developing, when there is overdevelopment, and when the film is deteriorated and there is contaminated solution. And insufficient contrast is, you get insufficient contrast when the film is underdeveloped, underexposed, or there is excessive KVP or film fog. There is dark spots or lines on the film when there are fingerprints, static discharge, excessive bending of the film. You know that the film is flexible, but you cannot exactly fold it into half and use it. That will lead to dark spots and lines on the film, and contaminated, when the film is contaminated with the developer even before processing. And the light spots occur on a film when the film is contaminated with fixer before processing, and contact with the container on the sides of the container. And yellow brown spots are due to insufficient washing, contaminated or depleted solution, and blurring of the image is usually due to movement of the patient while you are exposing the patient at double exposure. We'll see them with examples. We'll see a few with examples. So this is considered to be an ideal radiograph, where you are able to individually visualize each structures and you're able to differentiate between the structures. So what are all these structures? We'll see in our consecutive lectures, the normal anatomical radiograph. Here, what you have to understand is you're able to visualize the tooth, you know, the sharpness, the lines are defined, and the carious lesion is very well represented, and all the bone structure, the lining, and everything is clear demonstration. This is a considered an ideal radiograph. So these are light radiographs, where there is increased whiteness compared to that of darkness. This can be due to underdevelopment, as we spoke before, when it is diluted or contaminated developer and excessive fixation. Darker radiographs, where the contrast of the radiograph or the density of the radiograph is increased too much, so that you are not to some extent able to distinguish between the structures. And we saw the reasons of dark radiographs before itself. Film fogging, when you can see the difference between the ideal radiograph that we said before and the film fog, the fogged radiograph that we see below, the image below here. That is, there is some blurriness in that this thing, which reduces the quality of the image. This is referred to as film fog. And stains, stains that can be caused, this is because of contaminated solutions, water droplets, and also due to insufficient washing or insufficient processing. These kind of stains can occur on a radiograph. Then we have dark and light spots. We have already discussed this before. And then we have faulty radiographs. And to start off with, the first image that you see here on the top left corner, is there is blurring of the image. So this blurring of the image can be due to various reasons. One of the most common reasons being either the tube or the patient movement during exposure can be one of the prime reasons. And in the second one, second image on the first row, you can see that, or the middle image in the first row, you can see that there are brown stains. This is due to improper fixing. And in the third one, you can see multiple stains that are there on the radiograph. This could be probably due to contamination of the solution, either contamination of the developer or contamination of the fixer. And the first image in the, or the left image in the second row, you can very clearly see on the left hand side that there are some patterns that are there. This comes when you expose the film in the non-exposure side. I remember I told you before, there is an exposure side and a non-exposure side in a film. And when you expose the film to a non-exposure side, you get a lighter image with patterns like this, which are referred to as tire truck pattern. Okay. And again, the middle image that you see, this kind of breakage of image, or, you know, multiple images are seen when you accidentally expose the image twice inside the patient's mouth. The next one you see, where you see lines like a lightning bolt that is coming out of the tooth. This occurs when there is static energy discharge. Okay, we all know what is static electricity or static this thing. You would have done this in your school to demonstrate static current. Very common thing that they do is you run your comb along your hair, and when you run it along small bits of paper, these bits of paper will come and stick to the comb. This is one demonstration of static electricity. And when two surfaces come in contact, especially with this thing, there is some amount of static discharge. So if you pull the film out of the packet forcefully in a very fast, there is some amount of static discharge that is emitted within the film layer, and because of which you get such artifacts. And moving on to the films in the lower, the first and the second films, you can see there is film fogging in the lowermost, lower first image. And the second image, you can see these dark spots. And if you observe a little closely, you can see the fingerprint of a person. That is, you are never supposed to handle a radiographic film by touching the middle of it. You are supposed to handle it always along the edges. And if you accidentally touch while the film is still wet, or during processing, you might end up damaging the emulsion layer, thus translating either the imprint of the holder or imprint of your fingerprint directly on the image. And the last but not least is something called as a cone cut. Now this is not due to a processing error, this is due to the error usually while taking the image, when you do not cover the radiograph entirely using with your, you know, when you are not covering the image fully. That is, you position the radiograph but you do not position the tube properly and you do not cover the radiograph fully. That is, it doesn't come within the range of the this thing, you get something called as cone cut. So you can see only half the radiograph is exposed and half is not exposed. This happens when it is not covered fully. So let's summate so far what you have seen in the all three lectures so far. So we have seen the films used in intraoral radiology, we have seen its components and we have seen its composition. In intraoral radiology, we have learnt about IOPA, bisecting angle technique, occlusal, and we have also learnt about object localization. And then there is IOPA techniques, that is paralleling technique and bisecting angle technique. And then there is projection geometry, latent formation of latent image and its significance, the processing and methods of processing and radiograph, the image characteristics, and also the common radiographic faults that we come across while taking a radiograph. These are the things that we have seen. I recommend further read, please, as I always insist, please follow standardized textbooks, go through these topics that we have discussed in the lecture today. Lecture is not 100% and it cannot be 100% because I go in and talk about everything in detail, step by step, then what happens is that it consumes more, it requires more time of lecture. And it also becomes very difficult both for the lecturer and as well as the person who is listening to the lecture. When you have to sit there and listen for a very long time, you just lose, at some point of the time you just lose focus from the lecture. So we cannot go 100% into it. So we try to achieve this 100% using various things, with not just lecture. We'll combine this with demonstrations and we'll also have a practical session, and we'll have we'll be doing tests, that is test radiographs, that is we'll be you will be, before you actually do it on a patient, you'll be doing test radiographs on you can do it on dummies, you'll be doing it on objects, and you'll be doing it on subjects then later on. So we'll be combining it with demonstrations which will be given to you by a faculty, and then you will be doing it under the guidance. And when you combine all of this, the lecture, you might achieve a better understanding, but the best out of it can be achieved by reading and studying. Please go through textbooks, read, and if there is anything that you do not understand, please get back to me. We can hold a discussion via Google Meet, and by the time if you get back to the campus and we do get an opportunity to get a face-to-face interaction, we'll do that also. Otherwise, we can always meet in Google Meet, and we can always communicate via e-portal, WhatsApp. If there is any doubt, please let me know. And so far, whatever we have covered, please read it before the beginning of the before we move on to the next lecture. Because unless or until you understand the basic concepts that are there, the more difficult it is going to be for you for the future topics. Okay, so thank you and see you again in another lecture.